I'm really psyched to be here to talk to you about something that matters a lot to me. I'm Pam Melroy, the Deputy Administrator of NASA, and I have the privilege of helping to lead one of the most storied agencies in the federal government. We are a place where we make the impossible possible. In NASA's existence, we've put humanity onto the moon. We've sent spacecraft out through the solar system and actually beyond the solar system and landed rovers on Mars. We have deflected an asteroid. And we built a continuous presence in space with a multitude of nations. Why do we do this? Why do we go to space at all? What's the whole point? Well, the whole point is to benefit humanity through the unique ways that we can only do things from space. Firstly, science. So those breathtaking images of the James Webb Space Telescope, they're not just beautiful, they're actually literally a time machine looking back to the formation of the universe, telling us how the cosmos began. And you know what? Can't do it from the surface of the Earth. That incredible feat of engineering can only be achieved from space. When we go to low Earth orbit in microgravity, stripping away the effects of gravity shows incredible insights into biology and physics that we could never get any other way. And of course, if you want to study Earth holistically as a planet, you got to do it from space. There is no other way to do that. Next, the things that we do that are so incredibly hard just to get to space and back, to do all this exciting stuff, actually lifts our national scientific and technical capabilities. And that allows us to use those capabilities to solve other problems that benefit humanity. For example, a couple of my favorites, in the 60s, NASA gave the world food science and software engineering. Today, we are revolutionizing medical engineering, water reclamation, so many more things that will continue to benefit humanity. And then finally, inspiration. I have to say, as an astronaut, I have seen firsthand how space is unique in the way that it inspires the next generation. I mean, microgravity itself is super fun, right? Who doesn't want to fly without wings? Who doesn't want to lift giant objects with your pinky finger? It's like magic. It's really, really cool. And I have to say, observing the Earth from space, how beautiful it is, how inspiring it is, that is amazing. That inspiration fuels dreams. It fuels dreams in our children. And those dreams fuel ambitions for humanity to excel in the future and keep that virtuous cycle going. Let's talk about dreams for a moment. Humanity has dreamed forever of traveling to the stars. Well, guess what? We're ready to do it. This is the Artemis II crew, an amazing group of people. These four individuals are really, really, really special. And among them are the first woman, the first person of color, and the first non-American. Next year, we'll go around the moon on a test flight to prepare for our Artemis campaign and our Moon to Mars program. Through that program, we will launch people from around the world, people who look like you and me. We'll land them on the moon. We'll send them on to Mars, and we'll send them beyond. And this time, it's going to be different, because we're going to stay. We are truly entering a golden era of space. But let's stop and talk about that for a moment. What's going to happen to humanity as we become a multiplanetary species? How do we make sure that the benefits that we experience are equally passed around? How are we going to avoid some of those mistakes of the past? Well, we have some challenges. There's not much of a framework out there. We don't really have norms of behavior, and the only legal framework we've got is the Outer Space Treaty of 1967. Yeah, 1967. Seems like we got a little more work to do. I'm not really talking about what here, because NASA's got that, right? We understand the technology that we need. What I'm talking about is not spacecraft, but society. Well, we're thinking about that too. I think it's important that we do. And it won't surprise you to find out that a lot of people at NASA take their inspiration from science fiction. We battle, mostly jokingly, about which book or TV show or movie or franchise is better than the other. But hey, we actually have the opportunity, by examining outcomes that other people have imagined, to actually think about our choices for the future. So I have a question for you. As we push humanity out to the solar system and beyond, do we want the United Federation of Planets, or do we want the Imperial Senate? Now, as wickedly cool as lightsabers are, I actually think we really, really need to have something more like the United Federation of Planets for humanity to live long and prosper. Stop and think about it for a minute. This is a diversity of cultures that all come together under peaceful exploration for scientific purposes. That's the purpose of the Federation. There are principles, very important ones: equality, peace, progress for all. We want that too. We want to be safe. We want to be responsible. We want to be transparent. I have a favorite African proverb: if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. NASA thinks we want to go far because we think humanity wants us to go far. So if we're going with our international partners and all of humanity, we got to start thinking about what principles we're going to use going forward. In 2020, NASA, with seven other countries and the State Department, pulled together the Artemis Accords. Now 42 nations strong, the Artemis Accords were originally inspired by Star Trek's Kittimer Accords, and around this idea that if we can find common ground, common values, that we could ensure that exploring space is for the benefit of all. Crazy, right? You're looking at me going, utopian dreamer. That's absolutely nuts. We can't do that. Look at all the problems we have today. Well, guess what? NASA's already done it. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you the International Space Station, continuous human presence with a multitude of nations for almost 24 years. Together with our partners, Russia, Canada, Europe, and Japan, we have built a space station for microgravity science. 269 people from 21 countries have all visited the station for that purpose, to do science in microgravity. We make that science freely available to anyone around the world. We have a legal framework protecting us from a liability standpoint. But most importantly to me is that we've built a culture that has endured. It's a culture based on the highest standards of teamwork and cooperation, on scientific progress and inspiration. So really, we have done this. We just need to stay in that mindset going forward, that what we're going to do is to benefit all humanity by working together. Now, it kind of probably sounds like I'm knocking the Star Wars thing here, and I'm really not. I'd just like to remind you all that prior to Palpatine, it was a peaceful republic with an elected Senate and Jedi to protect those values. It was that bad guy. That bad guy Palpatine came in and tried to upend everything and kind of set up this existential battle between good and evil that's such a hallmark of the Star Wars universe. So you're going to ask me, well, aren't bad people going to go to space? Yeah, I think they will. But how you start off is incredibly important. And we've started off already on the right foot. We just need to extend that. It's an interesting thing about humanity. We like to kind of follow along with the culture we find ourselves in. If you go somewhere new, you sort of see how people are acting and you want to fit in some way. And so we have this amazing opportunity to build off this positive culture that we have already created and set humanity on a good path. And the Artemis Accords will help us thinking about those values going forward. How do we bring the best of humanity to space? The world's changing pretty fast. We've got a lot of technology out there, and it's changing really fast in space. We have new actors, we have international, new companies that are going to space. There's a lot going on there. And it's pretty cool, actually. It's kind of like a honeymoon phase a little bit. But that actually means we just need to be super vigilant. We really need to think about the societal implications of the things that we are doing. I reflect back 30 years ago with the internet. We saw the promise, but we didn't see the risks. We didn't see cybersecurity, privacy, misuse of social media. Hey, we gotta look at the past, and we gotta do better. Going to space is gonna benefit humanity in so many ways, not just the technologies we develop. We're gonna find out about the formation of life. We're gonna get new insights into our solar system, into our planet, into our own bodies. But as often been said, most recently by Spider-Man, with great power comes great responsibility. And guess what? You have a part in this. You have a say in this, because space is gonna change the world. At some point, space will impact everything we do. It will impact every industry. And you might even choose to go to space on vacation or for work. You'll have the opportunity to experience the culture I'm talking about and help us strengthen and nurture it and build it even further. That's incredibly important because the future of the universe and our grandchildren depends on what we choose. We do not want to choose something that is transactional, where the benefits of space accrue to only one nation or, God forbid, to a single individual. We want a universe based on peaceful exploration and cooperation. NASA aspires to do exactly that, and we will bring hope and unity to the world as we do it. So let's do it. Let's go far together. Thank you.